seen anything like it before. The all-new Sonata.
This, of course, is a debate that has been going on for a very long time. Perhaps today we are remembering because another young life has been lost. But at the end of the day, where do we draw the line and what conclusions do we draw? Should we believe that at the end of the day, India is incapable of protecting the girl child? Is there a virtual war on the girl child because nobody, it seems, is willing to care and protect for the female child? Dr. Meetu Khurana joins us here on our Headlines Today studio. She is an activist who's leading a fight, perhaps, to try and stop more unborn children being, perhaps, given an untimely death. Meenakshi Lekhi, always appreciate you joining us here on Headlines Today, and I want your legal opinion on this matter. Who's to blame? Is the law perhaps too soft, or it's the implementation? That is, of course, the question that we need to answer. And also joining us from Mumbai is Shaina NC from the BJP. My first question to you, Meetu, is very simple. What has your experience been? And I want our viewers to know a little bit of your background. You've actually had to fight to keep your daughters alive. And we are not talking about a village here. We are talking about an urban center. We are talking about Delhi. We're talking about a metropolis where a mother has to fight to keep her children alive. You were lucky. Other parents, in the last 2 days, we have reported two stories, were not so lucky.
So I was very lucky because my parents, when they sensed the danger to me and my unborn daughters, they brought me to their own home. Had they not brought me to their own home, perhaps I would have been a history.
What happened to you? Could you just tell us in 2 minutes, what was the reaction of your in-laws when they came to know that you had girl child on the
basically road? The problem started when they came to know that I'm carrying twins. So immediately they started forcing me for a sex determination test, which I resisted. I mean, they got it done by deception. They gave me a egg which had they gave me a cake which had egg, saying it's eggless, and they got an ultrasound done and it was revealed that I'm carrying girl children. After it, I was denied food. I was pushed down the staircase. I was made to sweep the, I mean, pocha lagao, just isliye I was not allowed to squat on the floor. My sister-in-law would tell me, ki, do this so that there's an early abortion. My parents would send homemade food for me to my in-law's house. My husband and my mother-in-law would sit in front of me and eat that. But that is a part of the struggle. The second part of the struggle began when I decided to stand up against this.
Okay.
When I filed the complaints. Every authority, every single authority I have been to, they have blamed me for dragging my in-laws and husband to the court and filing a case under the PNDT Act.
Who are these authorities?
The appropriate authorities were supposed to take action under the PNDT Act. The CDMO, he called me to his office and he told me that why are you spoiling your life? Give your husband a son if that's what he desires.
Meenakshi?
Yeah.
These are the protectors. These are the people who the Constitution says should protect us.
See, the protectors are the officers, but officers are run by individuals, and those individuals have their biases. And sometimes within the system, we can't clean the system in a manner that unbiased people head the officers. And that is what it seems happened here. People who are clean and unbiased are not heading the organizations. Organizations, on the contrary, are headed by people who are completely biased in their approach. And this is precisely what has happened, that if CMO or one of those people who are supposed to implement PNDT Act in totality,
yes,
and file complaints,
yes,
and proceed with the matter, are in fact part of the same group.
I can put it gang up
in a manner that instead of implementing the act, they are the ones who are the culprits.
So it was Afreen, now it is first Falak and then Afreen, tomorrow somebody else. What I want to know from you is there a provision where at least the law says make exemplary cases out of people who batter young children, especially girls? Has it ever been done? What I want to know is, has anybody been punished? And I'm talking about an urban center. Has anybody been punished for battering a girl child?
Yes, definitely, because you see, there's a slight difference, because Meetu's talking about PNDT Act, which is basically against the female feticide,
yes,
as a fetus. But here when we talk about Falak and Afreen, these two girls were born and they are infants. So there's infanticide also. One side is feticide, the other side is infanticide. And infanticide is happening, then it becomes a case of 302, which is murder. And both cases fall in the category of 302 and murder cases. And under murder charges, these people are going to be punished. And I'm sure there are n number of cases where under 302 people get punished.
But you wouldn't remember an example.
No, because I wouldn't remember example because 302 falls in a different category. Then the cases are usually evidence, etc., etc. There are different types: murder by strangulation, murder by giving rice. I mean, we all know across
murder
the country.
Murder by giving tobacco to a one-day-old girl.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, horrendous stories, and. I think the courts, the law, the police, everybody needs to gang up against such culprits now.
But unfortunately, they are ganging up with such culprits. Shaina, I want to know from you, somebody's got to take the blame. Who's taking the blame? Shall we just say this is a societal problem and hence nothing can be done about it? Or can they, or are there a few people who should say that, look, this is our responsibility and we'll do something about it? When was the last time perhaps a politician has made infanticide an election issue?
Well, let me just remind you that, you know, Prime Minister had said that this is a national shame and the country is going to work towards it. I really haven't seen much. If one talks about the PCP NDT Act, despite that, you have a 1,000 crore flourishing industry.
Yes.
Where you have greedy doctors, you have mischievous middlemen, you have a society that is obsessed with the male child and wants to only get to that male boy. You have a weak legislation where you have laws but nobody implementing it. And then you have murderers like in Afreen and Baby Falak's case.
Yes.
Where unfortunately, until and unless the courageous mother Reshma came up and spoke against Umar, who was not just a drug addict, but he tried to kill this 3-month-old repeatedly. I think that there is a need for the entire nation to stand up in outrage.
Okay.
You know, in 1829, when Lord William Bentinck talked about banning sati,
yes,
the entire nation was up in arms, but until 20 years back, one has not seen the complete abolition of sati. So I think it's important for all aspects in society, government and political will to act.
Okay.
Where there are, I'm glad Meenakshi Lekhi highlighted that, you know, infanticide and feticide are two different aspects and we need to focus on both.
But you're not answering my question. When was the last time a politician had made it an issue? I'm asking you, when was a politician... Are you aware of, would you remember of any politician making this an issue?
Akash, I could name a lot of women politicians who have made this not just a prime issue of concern or just to talk at certain cases, but who are on an ongoing basis working with NGOs.
Okay.
But you need to have political will to implement and to treat these cases as murder cases,
okay,
and not just as weak cases of domestic violence.
Neena Nayak, chairperson of the Karnataka State Commission for Protection for Child Rights, also joins us from Bangalore. Ma'am, we would like to know from you, first and foremost, what action are you going to take against this father who battered his young daughter to death? That's the first question we would like to know before we get to know exactly what all has been done over the last few years to protect such incidents from happening. Are you going to set an example in this case? There are a few cases that managed to really shake us up. This is one such case, whether be it Afreen or Falak. Are you going to help us make an example of this case?
Yes, yes. This is a really heart-rending case. I've just come back from the funeral. I saw this mother's sorrow. I mean, it could be anybody's daughter. It could be anybody's sister. And this Umar Farid, I just came to know from the police station that they have slapped IPC 302. So that's murder. So he can't get out that easily. But as for Afreen, I think she was a sacrifice that we all had to make, to shake up, to wake up, to reach out to each and every one of our sisters out there who are suffering in silence. Take the case of Reshma. It's not that she didn't go. Twice they went to the police station. Both the times, the Afreen came forward and relented and said, I'll do this. Now, all the police stations in Karnataka are supposed to have a women's cell.
Okay.
Now, why was there no follow-up? The whole system has failed as a systemic failure, and this case of Reshma is just a tip of the iceberg. I think we need to have quick response systems in every locality, in every community, and women like us who are empowered, who are educated. We must stand up and bring these women to a place where she can get support, she can talk, she can be herself. And then if she's not educated, come on, kind of empower her, give her a skill, give her a training, and tell her that she can live a dignified existence.
All that is fine, but what has the Karnataka State Commission for Protection of Child Rights done, ma'am? If I was to ask you, what has your commission done, what have you done to make sure that these cases don't happen again, would you have an adequate answer, ma'am? Because one thing we've been noticing is that there is no proactive measure. It's only retrospectively that we talk about such things.
Akash. Yes, true, very, very true. See, there's a system has to be in place. Government has got a lot of programs, shelters, short stay homes, and NGOs are also coming forward, but we don't have a quick response system. So this time we really seized this opportunity. Sad and very, very sad that with this Afreen's case had to do that. We've talked to the women's, we've got to the Women's Commission, we've talked to the Minority Commission.
Okay.
Tomorrow, in fact, we're having a long meeting with the Minority Commission to talk to them how can we work together to have a crisis intervention center.
Yes.
People like Reshma should come immediately and know that we are there for her.
And would you say that Reshma would get justice? Here's a wife who's saying that my husband should be punished adequately. Can you assure us here that such punishment would happen? Or would you say that no, your commission doesn't really have the rights, you don't have the power?
We are only a recommendary body. You must understand we have a limitation. But we can be proactive. We can put pressure on the state. Now, Karnataka is going to have a children's court very soon. So
okay.
I hope that this case is one of the first cases that come before the children's court, then, which means it will be fast-tracked. We'll get a good order. And that order should be a deterrent that nothing like this will ever happen. No one dare touch a woman like this, batter her. And not only batter her, give her such heart pain that even batter her own child, which she has to lose.
Before we go into
in
the
case,
specifics,
look at Reshma's baby.
Before we go into the specifics as to each and every point on how we are willing to kill a girl child before being born, while being born, after she's born, Shaina, you wanted to make a quick point before we go into the basics, the fundamentals of this case.
I just want to, you know, you were talking about that is the Women's Commission doing enough? I think the bigger question is society doing enough? Because this male obsession has to end.
Yes.
Whether it's inheritance, whether it's a limited budget, it's always the male. And, you know, eventually the larger question of who helps a woman, it's the woman who has to help herself. So it's all very well if she is economically independent. But you take Reshma's case, where she's a young girl who got married very young. At 20, she's had
Shaina,
to come out.
Are you saying that economically independent women don't face this? Economically independent women face it as much.
Absolutely.
That is at least what our research is suggesting.
All women face it, but I'm trying to distinguish between a case of a woman being economically self-sufficient and a case of Reshma, where she needs the support of all of us. And if it wasn't for the media, we wouldn't have even known of Afreen's case. So I think let's just make this into a larger issue where the entire nation is not just, you know, talking about this for 2 days and forgetting.
Yes.
We need to come up with logical conclusions.
Yes.
And those logical conclusions can be arrived only in a holistic fashion.
And who do you think is going to wake up the society? Unless and until it happens to be the politicians who get together and say that let's frame law, let's give the stick to the men who do such thing.
Absolutely, but there's no denying that fact. But it's not just about politicians, it's about the police registering cases, it's about the doctors who carry out cases, of premarital, where they determine sex,
okay.
They abort. The maximum cases of abortion happen in the affluent areas,
yes.
Like South Mumbai,
yes.
Where everyone is so educated and go out and spend 2,000 rupees on a sonography to determine sex,
okay.
And then to abort consequently.
Okay, let me go across to Meetu now. Meetu, now let's break this issue down. How can we stop this entire issue from happening? You know, prenatal, postnatal, infanticide is happening at any stage. Prenatal for the rich ones who can do it before, the poor ones do it afterwards. They don't have any such compulsions about killing a girl child, it seems. Not after what we've seen yesterday, feeding your daughter tobacco, at 1 day old daughter tobacco and killing her. How do we stop this? In your experience, as you've tried to mount a campaign to stop such deaths from happening, are these ultrasound clinics, is this complete failure on part of the state to stop them? Can we start off by saying that we're going to ban, we're going to seal, we're going to punish, we're going to send these people to life imprisonment who do this?
So I would first like to start with that if we want to stop it, we all have to wake up. If a woman wants to fight back, she wants to fight her in-laws to save her daughters, the society does not support her, the authorities do not support her today, the judiciary gives bail very easily in these cases, and once the culprits are out on the bail, then the cases just hang on and
as we might see, these killer fathers also get bail very soon.
He'll get bail and then the things will just go on dragging for years. And by till that time, the people are enjoying. In fact, recently I read about a case in which the doctor was arrested in 2004 under PNDT Act and let out on bail. And now in 2010, he was re-arrested after running a sex discrimination racket in 5 states.
Okay.
So the thing is that if the cases are not decided on a priority basis, if the authorities don't want to nab the culprits, they are hand in glove with the culprits who are doing this, the judiciary doesn't want to take these cases to fast track courts, then how is the woman supposed to come out and stand up alone?
This Meenakshi, this is quite a problem. Judiciary is a problem, basic law authority agencies are a problem, society is a problem. If there was to be a starting point where we deal with this problem, then what would you say? And fundamental question, is the law weak in itself in this case?
I don't think law is weak, but it may sound like a cliche, but I would still maintain that things have to start from your homes, from our homes. Because I think if I'm sitting here, the credit goes to my father, my husband, my brother, the men in my life who have supported me to be who I am.
Yes.
So I think it may sound like a cliche, but yet I would say no woman can survive of her own until and unless she has the support of men all around
her. And what about those women who don't have the support
of men? Yes, then in that case, I go back to what Shaina had to say, because she was talking about economic empowerment of women. And once they do not have the support, and they have fought against the system and they have survived, it helps them survive better. So that's where the distinction comes. It's not as if economically empowered women don't face these kinds of cases. They face the same. The only difference is if you are economically empowered, you are able to sustain yourself longer and you are able to fight back with more strength.
Okay.
So that's the only difference. But going back, an incorrect point was made, though, about Sati. Sati is banned. Sati is not there anymore.
It is.
We are talking about, I think, in this particular scenario, we need to go back to 498 and 406 history, that there was a time in 70s when dowry debts had increased. So judges, courts, and the legislation came out heavily on such crimes and amended the CRPC, amended IPC, and today people look at 498 and 406 as a weapon. Similarly, any death of a girl child, which may happen at any age, I would say less than 18 or 20 or whatever, every death should be reported, every death postmortem should happen and should be registered as a death under suspicious circumstances. Only after clearance from the police should these bodies be allowed to be buried or burnt, whatever. Otherwise, these cases should be investigated and law has to be strict in those circumstances.
Shaina, that's a valid point being made there. Let's strengthen the law. Let's put the fear of law. Maybe the law might be a little too harsh also. Could be misused on one or two rare occasions, but will serve a wider purpose, because this is getting out of hand now.
Absolutely, Akash. You know, in fact, the one narration I'd only like to give, that in China, you had so many women just disappear. And the moment the government decided to take it within their control, you now need to have a proper recording of where these women are, how they're missing, are they killed?
Yes.
What is the circumstances under which they're gone? So I think we need to do a lot of studies at our own level.
Okay.
But the only point I want to make in Reshma's case is that Reshma comes from an economically slightly lower section of society.
Okay.
She may not be as empowered as all of us. So let's make this not just a story of baby Afreen or baby Falak, but let's make this a story that the entire nation learns from, to change mindset, to change mentality, and to get out of this phase of saying, mujhe pota chahiye.
Okay.
Let's start saying, mujhe poti chahiye. Yeah, let's support people who, you know, have the guts to have girl child and to make sure that they do well
Shaina,
in every sphere. And I don't think we need to have many such examples, because we've already proven ourselves.
Shaina, till the time that we change our mindsets, and it seems that, well, India is having a serious issue changing its mindset, because going even by the affluent people, their whole desire for having a pota and not a poti is still very much there. Education doesn't change it seems. Money doesn't change it. It has to be the legal framework and the systems that change it. Given that, Would you say that our legal systems are actually working? Our bodies that are already there that are working? What about the protection for child rights, for example? Are these bodies actually working, or should they be answerable every time such incidents actually happen?
I don't think you can give an answer this way or that. It's subjective, it's case-wise. I think what they've done in Karnataka is phenomenal, because I've been monitoring this case from day one. The way they got Reshma out, gave her the courage to come out and speak, that also is a part of the process.
Okay.
So, you know, to sit here on judgment and say this is right or this is wrong, mm-hmm. is case-driven. But more importantly, if one talks about political will, one has legislation in place. The only appreciation that one would have in terms of the judiciary is if these cases are expedited and they're fast-tracked, and people like Umar are given their sentence at the earliest.
Neena, would you admit that committees and commissions like yours generally react to a situation? There is no proactiveness. Why is it that when the media comes out with such a case, then you go ahead, take suo motu cognizance, and then act? Could it not be that such commissions could have acted preemptively, and perhaps a baby girl wouldn't have lost her life today?
True, true. I totally agree with you, Akash. The trouble is there are systems in place. The systems are not functioning. And commissions like us and child welfare committees of the Juvenile Justice Act, we are reactive bodies. Complaints come to us and we take it up. Now, who is to play the proactive role? It's the state. They need to have systems in place. Our job is to see whether they are working, give recommendations. And in this case, time and again, we have been talking to the state. The commission is very proactively talking to the state for the last 2.5 years that children need protection. You need to have systems in place to receive children, to give a transit kind of a care to them and let them mainstream them. In the case of this young girl, very, very vulnerable young girl, it's not, she studied up to class 7.
Yes.
And she had this protective umbrella of a family, not that her family had abandoned her. She was not empowered enough.
Okay.
So I think each of us, we have to reach out to these children, reach out to these young women and give them the courage, tell them that they can fight it. We saw Reshma here.
Yes.
The Child Welfare Committee has been very active. We have been holding her hand.
Okay.
And now the politicians have also come forward. Just 5 minutes ago, I heard that one of the politicians has offered her 5 lakhs to move on with her life. So now Reshma, we will have to hold Reshma's hand. And we asked Reshma, what do you think, what kind of a message do you want to give girls?
Yes.
And she told me very clearly, please do zero tolerance to this kind of thing. I stood it too long.
Absolutely.
Not only was I hurt, because we saw a lot of scars on her body, cigarette butts. And now what the most painful thing is that she lost her child.
Mithu, did you take torture for a long period of time before you put your foot down? Perhaps the answer lies in saying zero tolerance, I'm not going to take this walk out. Or is it, am I putting it too simply?
So that is what I wanted to point out when ma'am was saying, because had her mother gone to the police station, the emphasis would have been, go back to your husband, try to save your marriage.
Mm.
Had she tried to run away with the child to somewhere else, the courts would have, like in my case, I went to each and every police station, I filed a complaint, but everywhere I was counseled, go back to your husband, try to save your marriage.
Yes.
Exactly.
Everywhere still I am facing
exactly
the pressure.
So then who's responsible, Neena? Then who's responsible? You're saying zero tolerance, okay, the lady goes ahead.
We are to fault. We middle class Indians are to fault. We did not push the government. We did not be proactive to educate our girls. How are we left almost 30-40% of our girls illiterate? Where do they go? They don't know what the system is.
So would I be wrong, Neena? Would I be wrong to say that the state is the one that is killing these girls, because the state is supposed to protect them? The state hasn't been able to empower them or educate them or make them aware.
Let's say state. We have good laws. The state has failed this child. Definitely, the state has failed it. We need to have systems. State, I include commissions, committees, all of us who are responsible, civil society. Could we not demand, if it happened to my daughter, would I keep quiet? I would stamp my foot and go and fight at the police station.
Meenakshi, I want to know from you also, has the state failed us? Is the state the one that is killing? Can we get away by just saying, no, it's a societal problem? The state is supposed to give the society a bit of a stick.
I think we can't really make a distinction between state and the society in these particular cases, for the simple reason state comes into play only when the family breaks down and family fails.
Mm.
So the matter reaches the state once the woman is out of the house onto the street, and at that time the state can intervene. But
There are countries where the state intervenes when they look at how the father and mother are bringing
coming,
up the kid.
I'm coming to that. So until and unless, you see, the state machinery, it's a huge economic question also involved with the state. Their state welfare. I think I was coming to the point that the systems need to be very simple, and they have to be simplified.
Okay.
There has to be a policing authority.
Accessible.
Which needs to take care of the culprits and
yes.
Once the criminals are there. There has to be a proactive welfare system.
Absolutely.
And welfare systems need to be strengthened, that if a woman walks out of the house, what is it that we are going to do? And there is another thing which I would require state to intervene and come forward with is criminal justice compensation system.
Mm.
That if a woman is out of the house, she has no way to sustain herself. So are we empowering her to go back to work? Are we giving her succor during that period?
Meenakshi,
are we giving her money?
When you're telling me all these things haven't been done.
No.
60 years have passed.
Yes.
Then I'm right in saying that the state is responsible for these girls dying.
Absolutely. Absolutely. No, I am there. I am with you. All I'm saying is the state and the social distinction cannot be maintained because somewhere families have also failed.
Okay.
And on top, state has also failed to protect.
Yes.
So it's a combined effort at denying justice rather than giving justice.
Perhaps the responsibility lies and the onus lies more on the state, because sometimes, yes, the family could also be in the wrong. Shaira, I'd say last few minutes left, final comment.
Quickly.
Can we blame the state? Can we say that blaming society is the easy way out?
Akash, I was just coming to that. You just take examples of two states, Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat.
Mm.
The kind of impetus they have given, the kind of importance they have given to the Ladli Lakshmi Yojana, to the girl child, and the incentives they've given to the families that they'll take care of their education, take care of X amount at the time of their wedding, take
okay.
care of all the other perks.
Mm.
I think these are incentives and these are good examples to learn from.
Okay.
Don't go by which state is running what kind of a campaign. As
okay.
long as they're proactively working and they're working towards empowering the girl child, I think that's all that's important.
One final line. Meenakshi, absolutely running out of time.
Final line is, don't politicize women rights issues, and that's what happens.
Okay. Completely running out of time, Meetu Khurana. Many thanks for joining us here on our Headlines Today studios. Meenakshi Lekhi, completely running out of time, Shaina. Shaina, apologize, completely running out of time here. Neena Nayak, one honestly hopes that the women's rights commissions can do a lot more than just take suo motu cognizance of what is reported in the media, and that we can proactively control such incidents from happening in the future. Meenakshi Lekhi, many thanks for your incisive points. Completely running out of time here on Headlines Today. We'll, of course, keep a track on that case, and hopefully we don't have to report on an infant death anytime in the near future.
अरे गेम स्टार्ट हो रहा है यार.
हाँ गेम ही स्टार्ट हो रहा है. टोल टो
टो से क्या शुरू होता है.
टोल प्लाजा
प्लाजा जा, 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 से क्या शुरू होता है.
जैप कैफे
पे 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 पे
फेम स्पा
और पास से
पालम जी
में जाना है क्या अंदर.
वैसे इस गेम का नाम क्या है.
Altakshari.
Explore your city with India's search engine, Alto. Let's go.
The world has changed.
I doubt anything would surprise me.
We are hopelessly outgunned.
Mr. Stark.
Captain, it's time. I still believe in heroes.
ऐसे दिखाइए बढ़िया सा
वेस्टर्न
कंप्रेसर
जापानीज
कूलिंग कॉइल
कॉपर
एनर्जी रेटिंग
फाइव स्टार
मेंटेनेंस